Yeah. All right. So let us give you a little bit of a background, why we're here and why we're playing Beatles songs. I mean, I kind of think that it's a universal thing that everybody loves the Beatles. I like to think that. I know it's not necessarily true, but I like to think that, it's pretty unoffensive music these days. I grew up listening to the Beatles. I mean, I'm pretty young. I was born in the early 80s, but my parents listened to the Beatles, and so it was always present in my life. Mo has been a huge Beatles fan all of her life as well.
What do you learn when you're learning guitar?
Right,
Beatles.
exactly.
Actually, my first song was Snoopy and the Red Baron, but that's another story.
We've both had Beatles influences in our life. At the beginning of the pandemic, in March, last March, the 18th of March, 2020. It was that time when we were getting news reports to like say, don't leave your house. You need to stay home. It's not really safe to go out if you don't have to. You know, it was kind of like the beginning of a zombie movie. You know, it was kind of terrifying. But this really nice thing was going on, particularly on Facebook, where a lot of the musical people that we knew, anybody that was connected to music in any way, or the arts in any way, were getting onto Facebook, and people were playing songs for one another and reading Harry Potter to one another, reciting poetry just to kind of like, distract people and kind of ease
Raise
people.
their spirits,
Yeah, and
keep
it.
them focused on connecting.
Yeah, and besides the fact that whatever was going on outside was terrifying, it was actually a really nice movement that was happening. So Mo and I thought, hey, we can do something like that. We could play a song for our friends and, jump on the bandwagon. And so we decided to play a song that we knew fairly well. It was a Beatles song. We played it in a band that we used to play in. And so we had a couple of practices. We recorded it. And we posted it on Facebook, and everybody loved it, and it got a bunch of views, in the first 48 hours, like probably
Like,
about 5,000 views,
yeah,
because
like people
we're
were.
connected to a large community, so it
Oh,
kind
yeah,
of it,
it's
it blew up.
unexpected.
But in that video, that very first video that we put out, Mo said, "Hey, maybe we'll play a Beatles song every day until the pandemic's over." So, 2 weeks went by and we did it for 2 weeks. And then,
Three
we were
weeks.
still there a month later.
Then 2 months.
Then 3 years. And then we had like day 50 celebration. And it was like, wow, we're still here 50 days
And
later.
then our bandmate from Stockholm, Matthias, wrote in and said, I hope you guys are keep going to day 100.
Yeah, and then we got to day 100 and we started doing some live shows on Facebook. So it kind of, spiraled into a thing. So today, is actually day 432. We've played a Beatles song and recorded it and posted it on social media every single day since last March. And so we've gathered this community of complete Beatles nerds who are not only are they Beatles nerds, but they're now Beatles a day nerds. So our community is called Beatles a Day with Mo and Amelia.
Yeah. What's really interesting about that community actually is that a lot of these people have gotten to know each other just from sharing things on posts about this song reminds me of, and they're telling their stories and now they're starting to talk to each other, and it's odd, but it's very, very cool how people have been connecting around like some comfort. It's like the macaroni and cheese of music. It's comfort food, right?
Yeah,
So
definitely.
it's very cool that it's actually through the separation, we've been able to find ways as people, as communities, to continue to think more deeply and connect more purposefully with one another. And that's one of the biggest takeaways, I think, from this adventure so far.
And we're in Toronto, and we've seemed to have amassed people from all over the world, like mostly North America, the UK,
New
Europe.
Zealand, Australia,
Yeah, Moscow. We've got somebody
Europe, yeah,
who
Moscow,
listens regularly.
Indonesia.
Yeah.
It's
So
very fun.
So it's been an odd journey, and we'll take you through some of the oddities and wonderfulness of the last 432 days. But first, we'll play some music.
That's what we're here to do.
We encourage you, highly encourage you, to sing along and play along at home. We're going to sing, the first song is going to be Gotta Get You Into My Life. So I think we've got some lyrics for you. I think Chuck's going to post those in the chat for you. By the way, feel free to use the chat function today and ask us questions, make comments. You know, we'd love to interact with you that way. If you have anything to shake, like if you've got shakers or kazoos, you know, or cowbells or whatever, please do use those. If you don't have any shakers in your house, go to your medicine cabinet and find, you know, something in a plastic bottle that's got tablets in it, and it makes a great shaker. You can use anything, B12, you know, blood pressure medication.
Be prepared to eat dust when you're
yeah
done.
Right, peppercorns work really well as well. So if you want to post the lyrics up there, I don't know how you want to share those, Chuck, but we're gonna do Gotta Get You Into My Life.
Oh, that means
you gotta have a kazoo.
I do.
I got it. Oh, there we go. Yay. Excellent. Mm. Okay. We're going to kazoo.
Whoop. Oh. Kazoo down.
Kazoo down.
I literally...
Luckily, we have...
Just spit my kazoo right out of my mouth.
A backup kazoo. That one's got a bit of cat hair on it, so... All right. I'm going to just take my ear out here so I can show you what's going on.
I might lose the kazoo halfway through.
Uncasted.
All right, we'll see what happens.
I got my frog and my shaker here.
A frog and your shaker? That's great. Ready?
One, two, three, four.
Tick it, tick
it. I was alone, I took a ride, I didn't know what I would find there. Another road.
All of the Beatles songs that actually really fit a Sunday service. It's
yeah.
Fantastic.
Gotta Get You Into My Life.
Right?
I gotta get you all into my life. You know, I must confess, growing up in the UK, my parents were raised fairly heavily Catholic in the 50s and 60s. And so, you know, it wasn't a great experience for them. And so consequently, you know, my parents didn't raise their children in the church. And I've always kind of had this, you know, kind of very big disconnect with it, even though I went to kind of like Church of England schools. But I've often thought that I would love to have, you know, a community similar to what you have. You know, the Unitarian Universalism is a very, very, it's something very attractive that I think as a spiritual person I could, you know, I could definitely get into. Right. So I got to get you into my life. But actually, Paul McCartney wrote this song. He said that it was an ode to pot. Everybody thought that it was, you know, kind of a love song for someone or whatever.
Oh, it was a love song, I guess.
Yeah, it was a love song, but it was an ode to pot. And he said that it was an ode to pot the way that anybody would write an ode to chocolate or a fine claret. So, you know, I don't know. But it is a great song. And some other great versions out there, particularly the Earth, Wind & Fire version.
The grooviest version of all.
The grooviest version of all. Mm. We actually used to live in Sweden before we moved back to Canada. And our band was called The Soul Providers. So, and we were very, very groovy.
And we really, really played that song a lot.
So I want to share with you, you know, this community that we've built. We have some wonderful people in our community, and they send us things in the mail. And so with the help of our friends, we have amassed a collection of very impressive percussion instruments. So I just want to share some with you. I have one that looks like a banana, which is my favorite now, which is excellent. And you can also use it to play banana phone.
But can you use it this way? I guess you could. You're swinging.
I also have two that look like skulls, which are pretty cool.
Very rock and roll.
Yeah, very rock and roll. We've been sent cowbells in the mail. You know, cowbell in the mail.
People are very generous.
Yes, people have been extremely generous. People hand make things for us. This is our logo, Beatles A Day logo.
Painted on a rock.
Yeah.
Check.
Chuck's got his shirt on with the Beatles on the back. And we have seen an outpouring of generosity from our community that I personally have never experienced the likes of. You know, people drive to our house and drop off vegetables that they've grown in their gardens. I mean, it's quite wonderful. And this still smells like fresh paint, and it smells pretty, pretty awesome. All right, we shall do another song. Let us move to Here Comes the Sun, which George Harrison wrote in Eric Clapton's garden. You know, it kind of seems ironic that, you know, George Harrison would write a song about the sun in a British garden, because we don't see a lot of sun. But it really is one of the most wonderful Beatles songs. So if you want to copy and paste the lyrics there, this is a particular favourite of lots of people. There we go. And I think this definitely applies to the situation that we're all living in right now.
Hopefully,
you know, this being a light at the end of the tunnel. All right, I'm going to remove my earpiece again.
Depends how you spell sun.
Right.
Ready?
Yeah. Here comes the sun, doo-doo-doo-doo. Here comes the sun.
Here comes the sun, doo-doo-doo-doo.
Was ever a more symbolic song for, you know, coming out the other side of what we've been through in the last 14 months, I think that's it. You know, Little Darling, it feels like years since it's been here. I know somebody said that they were going visiting family and, you know, visiting family in Tennessee and master's graduations, and it just feels like such a long time. And I'm seeing in the UK, where all of my family are, you know, I'm seeing people being able to go to the pub now and sit with one another and enjoy drinks, and you know, they've had a really great vaccination rollout, and now they're getting to spend time with each other again. Things are a little different here in Canada right now, but
to be fair, in Britain, if you go to the pub with your friends, like, the pub is kind of like going to somebody's living room to gather. It's a real community hub in every little British town. It's kind of like going to the community center to play pool with your friends.
Yeah.
It's not like going to the pub in North America. It's like you go out and you drink.
Yeah, it's a very community-focused activity. There just happens to be alcohol.
You eat steak and peas and
stuff. You have your bag of crisps, you know, because they're crisps in the UK. You know, if everybody's got their own bag of crisps, that's fine. But usually what would happen is you would have a bag of crisps. And in the UK, bags of crisps are this big. They're not like this big.
This is the symbology of sharing that she's talking about right now. Here it comes.
And what you have to do, if you go to the pub and you're all sitting around a table, you open your crisps, but then you open it down the center as well. So the whole foil of the pack, you know, serves as a plate. And then you all take from the pile of crisps. That's how you share your crisps. You can keep them to yourself if you want.
Cultural,
you
know, things that we get to learn about sharing and caring.
Right. That's the ultimate in community, is sharing your bag of crisps with your pint. So there we go. So yeah, I mean, you know, we're a little bit behind here in Canada. Things are still a little bit slow, but you know, that song reminds me, Here Comes the Sun, that eventually we'll all be able to hug again. And
true.
Yeah.
But, you know, the sun is something, truthfully, the sun is something that we carry within us. Like, we can be the deliverer of that sun wherever we go. You know, that ray of sunlight, that shine, that glisten that we put on things, in the way that we treat other people, the way that, like, you just never know if you're the sunlight that walks into somebody's life that represents what they need today. And, you know, when you opened earlier, talk about compassion and caring, really, that's kind of the job, isn't it? That's our job. And all of these songs, especially this next one, is it just reminds me, you know, to be of service. Actually, this is a song for me, a service, like, across the universe.
Yeah, this is going to be across the universe, so you'll want to get your lyrics ready. And actually, how this song came about is quite interesting, because John Lennon, especially particularly as a young man, had a lot of trauma from his childhood around his parental situation and abandonment issues. And so they kind of manifested, that manifested itself into a lot of anger.
He had a lot of healing to do on his spiritual journey.
Yes, and you know, in the earlier works of John Lennon, you can tell he was expressing a lot of frustration. He would write a lot of songs around codependency with women, and you know, possessiveness over women in his life. But as he got older, he started to write songs that were more spiritually focused, especially at that time, after the time that they had been in India in 1968, and they had been meditating with the Maharishi. That was a switch in John's life, and it also coincided with the time that he met Yoko Ono as well. And so he started to have this spiritual shift. And so how this song came about, this was just kind of on the cusp. This was 1968-69, and there was kind of a crossover in the breakdown of his marriage to Cynthia and then with Yoko. And he said that this song was inspired by, he must have had an argument with Cynthia. You know, and she was saying, oh, you keep going on, and you know, you're just saying words. And so he went away in an angry way to try and write this song, and he thought, you know, instead of putting this inspiration into a song that's going to be you know, contemptuous and angry, I'm actually going to spin it into something a little bit more cosmic. He used the word cosmic. Mm. And out came this great song, which is on Let It Be. And this is definitely another one of my favorite. They're all my favorites. What can I say? Yeah. It's like, yeah. It's hard to pick. All right.
Are you prepared?
Yes, I am ready. Let's do a little bit of shaking.
Okay.
Yep. Yep.
Okay.
One, two, three.
I got it.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what? I'm going to try that again. I got thrown off by the shaker. I'm sorry. I was like, I hadn't prepared this with you.
They slither while they pass, they slip away across the universe. Pools of sorrow, waves of joy are drifting through my opened mind, possessing and caressing me. Jaguru. Change my world.
I was gonna go to fade. I was like, we could have been here all morning just fading out.
That's such a lovely sentiment in this song, and the Jagarudeva.
Yeah.
You know the meaning of these lyrics.
I do, yes. And I had to write them down, so bear with me, because I would never have remembered them. You know, it's something that I would not have committed to memory. So it literally, in Sanskrit, Jagarudeva literally translates to glory to the shining remover of darkness, but can be paraphrased as victory to God divine, or hail to the divine guru. So Jagarudeva, glory to the shining remover of darkness.
Isn't that beautiful? Yeah. It's a lovely sentiment, the shining remover of darkness.
Yeah.
This, you know, the spiritual journey that the Beatles went on so closely aligns to, I mean, they lived their lives so very publicly.
Mm.
You know, we saw all of their humanity on display, from, you know, the violence that John Lennon, you know, struggled with as a younger man, through addiction, through all sorts of things. And this yearning and this search for spiritual freedom, it really, you can see it living themselves, living itself out in that 10-year period that the Beatles were seriously active, and then afterwards in their solo works as well, when they went their own ways. Just such an incredible eye-opening gift lyrically, as a songwriter, just wondering, when people in the 60s were like, what are they saying? What are they trying to say? There's hidden codes in here. And you know what? There's hidden codes all over all of it, and especially when you look through spiritual eyes, there is just so much life force, struggle and surrender and redemption happening in almost all of these later works, especially from John Lennon. It's pretty profound, and it's pretty lovely that this was a gift that he left to us.
Mm-hmm. So that said,
yes,
we will move on to All You Need Is Love, which was written to celebrate the broadcasting, the first satellite broadcasting of, I can't remember how many TV stations it was, but all of the major global TV stations across the world. I think it must have been in 1969, it must have been. They did a satellite cast. I don't know if anybody remembers that happening. So they did a satellite cast where all of these major TV stations across the world,
I watched it,
broadcast at the same time. And the Beatles, you know, being the British representative for the BBC, they were asked to write a song for the occasion. And All You Need Is Love was the song that they wrote. And I do believe that they wrote it and recorded it in 72 hours. They wrote it and record, it's not 72 hours, I think it was like 5 days. It was really short, because they had just put out Abbey Road. I think they had just put out Abbey Road. And then, you know, they had like 5 days or a week to kind of turn this song around. So they did it in like a remarkable amount of time. And then I'm pretty sure they played it live on the event with literally billions of people watching.
Yeah.
So if you happen to have a kazoo lying around your house, you will need a kazoo.
Or a mouth trumpet works too.
Or a mouth trumpet, yeah. Or a comb with a piece of, you know, tissue paper over it.
So this song is also one of those songs that there's a lot going on in it, even though it seems really simple. If you look at these lyrics, you know, there's nothing you can make that can't be made. There's no one you can save that can't be saved. What a great line.
Yeah.
What a great line. There's no one you can save that can't be saved. There's nothing you can be, but you can learn how to
be
you
in
time. So
yeah.
I'm really happy to play this song. Now, there's a lot of stuff going on if you know the recording very well. And I just love that Susan's holding up like all the albums. I don't know if you guys, you might be busy reading the lyrics, but every time a song comes on, Susan's holding up like a new Beatles album, like the legitimate vinyl. It's really awesome.
You can't find that stuff anywhere now.
Yeah, you got to go looking.
You got to go.
Flea markets everywhere.
Yeah, and who's running flea markets right now?
Yeah. So that's really your CD and CDs.
Oh, and CDs.
That's actually my favorite Beatles album cover, that one.
Yeah.
This one has a lot of instruments playing at the end. There's saxophone, there's trumpets, there's
green sleeves.
Yeah, in out of meter and in an odd key. There's a lot going on, so if you know this album, please try and chime in at the end. I'm going to try and recreate it, but wish me luck. I'll do my best. You ready?
Ready, and...
sing that can't be sung. Nothing you can say, but you can learn how to play the game. It's easy. There's nothing you can make that can't be made. No one you can save that can't be saved. Nothing you can be, but you can learn how to be in time. It's easy.
You did well.
We tried to get everything in there.
You did well. You did fairly well.
I forgot the she loves you part.
You did. This is like the best bit. Sorry,
Love is all you need.
I had your back.
Love is all you need. Love is all you need. I don't think that can be repeated enough.
By the way, I can't not do the all you need is love.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, right.
With the Beatles or any whoever is doing it.
Right? That's great.
I gotta go for that.
I'm so glad that you do that, Chuck.
I think for that end part, we could have all just unmuted and just gone for it, right? And even if it didn't match up, it would have been great.
Right? You know what? It wouldn't have mattered if it wasn't in time. You want to try it?
Yeah.
Let's unmute. Everybody unmute. And we'll just do the end part and see what happens.
I love it.
And you know what? If you put it on Spotlight, whoever's making the most sound will pop up onto the screen at the same time. Like, if we're all muted.
It'll always be us.
No, it won't.
Because we're making the most noise.
No, well, it's a noise off.
Ooh. Challenge accepted.
All right, everybody off mute. We're going to sing the end of this. Because it doesn't matter.
One, two, three.
Love is all you need.
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 Love is
all you need. Love is all you need.
Love
Love is all you need.
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 Oh my fabulous. God, no.
Fabulous.
That's great. Cool. Because I have ADHD, so I just kind of like want to do what the other person in my ear is doing. So I can't stay on my thing.
That was wonderful. It was lovely hearing it just coming in all over the place. That was just like the record. And we've got a recording of this too, so you can release this. The greatest.
Right.
Fantastic.
Alrighty.
So this next song is Amelia's going to introduce this next song. Now, this originally, just think about these lyrics when they're flying past, and actually how suitable they are for this morning's service together.
Yes.
But Amelia.
Please open your hymnal and go to page 6 for "Till There Was You." Now, a couple of things about this song. Firstly. Lots of people might recognize this song from The Music Man. Anybody a Music Man fan?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. So
that rhymes with pool.
So this was, before it was in The Music Man, Meredith Wilson had written a version of this, a different version of it. So the bones were the same, but it was slightly different. And it was in the early 50s. And then when he came to write The Music Man, he had this song and he retooled it for the musical. So we put it in the musical in 1957. In the early 60s, the Beatles picked it up because they Paul loved to croon and he loved a ballad. The Beatles put this on my side of the Atlantic. It was on With the Beatles. The estate, when Meredith passed, the estate of Meredith Wilson earned more in royalties from the Beatles version than they did from anything connected to the musical. So the Beatles really repopularized this song.
So it goes to show that always be the second person to do a thing.
Right. Now, on a personal level,
there it is. Meet the Beatles.
There you go. Right. That's Meet the Beatles. Oh, that's so good. I'm so jealous.
Can I just interject that we're running up against the clock, this be the closer?
Absolutely, yes.
Sure.
So I just want to share something with you. On the 6th of May this year, which is only 2 weeks ago, my father passed away. And my entire family are in the UK. I'm the only one that lives in Canada. And so because of COVID, I can't be with my family right now. And tomorrow is going to be his funeral service, which I have to watch on a webcast, which is both heartbreaking and relieving at the same time that I get to actually watch it. But I, in his passing, in talking to my brother, I learned that this song was my dad's favorite song. My dad was the person that introduced me to the Beatles. And so I always feel a connection to my dad anyway, because of this project that we've done for the last 430 odd days. But now knowing that this was his song, and he watched every single day, he watched our episodes every single day. So even though I didn't see him, he saw me every single day. And so I gratuitously put this in the set list today, because this song will now forever connect me to my dad. And I will always have this project and the Beatles to connect me to my dad. So I hope you don't mind indulging me as we sing this song, and I get to just keep my dad in my memory today. You want to start that again?
There were bells on a hill, but I never heard them ringing. No, I never heard them at all, till there was you. There were birds in the sky, but I never saw them winging. No, I never saw them at all, was you. Then there was music and wonderful roses. They tell me in sweet fragrant meadows of dawn and dew.
Thank you.
There was love. Sorry. All around, but I never heard it singing. No, I never
sorry about the bridge.
Did you have a moment?
Well, I can't actually. I'm trying to read the chords, and I couldn't actually read the chords because my eyes are so glassy from being so tired. I'm sorry.
We did it a cappella. We're a cappella musicians.
Yes.
We got to do that.
Music, wonderful roses, they tell me.
You got it the second time. It's okay.
No, I almost. I'm sorry, Rose. Anyway.
It's been a difficult couple of weeks, you know, trying to grieve from afar.
Yeah, it's hard to play through this song, actually.
Yeah, and we thank you for letting us, you know, tack that one onto the end there. So, knowing that we're up against the clock, we should probably thank you.
I'm sorry.
It's all right. We should probably thank you for inviting us today. Thank you, Chuck. This has been wonderful to play some alternative songs, actually, that we don't normally play for people.
Yeah, it was great. It was lovely. Thank you.
And they decided to call the movie Help. because he wrote the song. Alrighty, shall we? Shall we do a thing?
Yep. Have we got the, oh yeah, have we got the, yeah, there we go. All right, it's all up there for you. I'm so glad you're letting us do one more song for you.
Thanks.
One, two, three, and help.